Are you as excited about the DLF Ultima sales being very good?
Not excited. Observing carefully is more like it. I think the problem
doesn't signal
deeper.
The end of the worst for luxury housing. No.
Well, frankly, I don't think I'm going to take a call on investing in India based on what happens to luxury housing. You know, it's like trying to figure out what's happening in the country based on how many BMWs are sold.
No, it's just that
or how many people
housing was affecting NBFC, NBFC was affecting banks. So
yeah.
That's why I'm asking you if it is removing one big major.
So luxury problem. Housing, some of it may be funded with huge, you know, mountains of debt, but it's not a systemic issue that worries us.
Okay. Mm.
The systemic issue is, of course, the question of liquidity for NBFCs, many of which have lent to real estate and where sales velocity has fallen off the cliff for a particular price point and higher, but even now increasingly in the lower price points. And it's in the lower price points, the sub 50 lakh rupee homes, where sales velocity increasing will be a much better indicator of whether things can improve in the NBFC sector.
Okay, the market is very volatile. That gap up is now getting sold into a bit, little bit. Nifty's gains are only 21 points. The bank Nifty also after 300 point gains is down to 160. Still gains, of course, but let's see. Tata Motors, of course, is the big gainer. That has sort of dual benefit if trade deal happens, and also this talk of a fresh negotiation on Brexit. So that's helping Tata Motors. But Dipen, good morning. One interesting aspect of market over the last 1 week was this US FDA action again on some of the Indian large cap pharma names. And again, we started to see big decline in names like Aurobindo Pharma.
Right.
Are you a buyer here?
So we've seen it in the financials, which have some of which are arguably not so well managed. Mm. That just because something's fallen doesn't mean it can't fall more or that it can't fall again. And if there is a systemic breakdown, if there's a breakdown in faith, if there's a breakdown in trust, if you guys are not playing the game by the rules. So look at financials, look at pharma. There are stringent rules in all these sectors, right? Mm-hmm. I'm trying to take a broader abstract picture here. And the fear is, the prices are telling you that investors fear that there is again, misbehavior on a large scale or non-compliance. Let's look at the milder word for it, on a larger scale than what we might have thought. Otherwise, the pharma index being at I don't know how many years low and multiples, some of them actually looking at, single digit for some companies, low teens for some others. And it's, what have you, it's supposed to be a knowledge sector. It's supposed to be a sector where we've beaten the rest of the world hollow for some time. And then if this is the kind of, malfeasance that is alleged to be happening with respect to compliance in a compliance heavy sector, in a highly regulated sector, then there is certainly loss of faith. That's a broad brush picture.
Okay.
Of course, a lot of these companies have pulled back from these setbacks in the past, and there's no reason why they can't do it again.
I just want to point out that Tata Motors is now up over 4%, and it's actually been rallying ever since it posted its China sales last week, and it's been a third consecutive month of a double-digit growth in the Chinese market for Tata Motors particularly. So look at that. That's just flying away over there. But Dipen, good morning. I was going through your note, and very interesting in that you said that you've downgraded your multiples on TCS from 24 times to 20 times 1 year forward. It's already underperformed Infosys quite a bit this year.
Right.
You think that underperformance will continue? And between TCS and Infosys now, how do you position yourself?
Yeah, you're not leaving me with much of a choice, Sonia, because we've now got neutrals on both of these leaders.
Oh.
And we are disappointed with TCS because we've been thumping the table for a while on them, believing in their superior growth trajectory. And it was only a matter of time before that growth should have come back, but it hasn't. And the slowdown in headline growth from, 13-14% level to 8-9 kind of number looks actually, I hate using the word sustainable. this is sticky, it's not going to, I don't think TCS is going to get back to 12-13% growth in a hurry, is the sense we are getting. That's the vibe we got from the company on the con call. And then if that is the case, then the 24x looks rich. Okay, so which is why we've downgraded them from 24x to 20x, and it's the downgrade in the multiple more than the tweaking around with minor tweaks
what
in the earnings.
What about Infosys? Did you upgrade
now,
the multiple there?
No, we didn't. Infosys, we are still at 18x, and look at that big you know, gap that was there, and we still have a neutral on Infosys. We do like the fact, and we had a buy for the longest time on the stock, but I think much of the improvement in the growth trajectory is baked in the price, and that margin uptick that you saw has got everybody excited. They are at 21.7% EBIT margin this quarter, and people are suspecting that the margin sacrifice is over for growth. We have a slightly different perspective here. We believe that the pricing environment is not exciting. Many of their large wins are essentially renewals, which means there would be pricing pressure there as well. It's a great company. They're doing all the right things. There's no denying the fact. And both these companies are paying out anywhere between 80 to 100% of FCF. They're both at 2.5% kind of percent dividend yields. But the growth numbers are simply not exciting enough for us to thumb the table on valuations.
Okay.
You know, that's the thing.
Fair enough.
On if I may complete the point, sorry. On frontline IT, the only buy that we have right now is, guess what, HCL Tech. 13-14x one-year out numbers, and a whole lot of money reinvested, more than $2 billion reinvested over the last year into inorganic acquisitions. Perhaps the only IT services, Indian IT services company reinvesting this much money. I hope all of that pays off. Right now, the debate is open.
Okay. There's a bit of a distress factor with IndusInd Bank,
right.
You know, Deepin. Is that giving a buying opportunity? You think the you know, the market's fearing something, and who knows, perhaps the derating may continue.
Yes, so the easiest and reckless thing to say is there a hole in IndusInd? You know, they declared that 3,000 odd crore exposure to the ILFS group a couple of quarters ago, and they took huge write-offs. Comparable growth, if I can call it that, after the Bharat financial inclusion, shall I say, into the numbers, is down now to 13% from the mid-20s, as it used to be. We were used to an IndusInd that was galloping, if not, you know, running away.
No points, brownie points for being at 20 to 25 at a time when the economy is slowing. Prudence, isn't it?
Well, there are very, very respectable exceptions to that claim of yours. There are financial services companies which continue to grow in their defined bracket of 15 to 20%. The Bajaj Finances of the world are growing even faster. My own parent bank is another example. And while, you know, we don't have recommendations on the last two stocks that I mentioned, the point is there is a way to grow. And at 2 lakh crores loan book, with so many PSU banks withdrawing, as it were, from the market, no matter that they've got a recap right now, I don't think it's a big ask to grow. The question that investors are asking is, have you suddenly turned cautious on your lending because you're afraid that the lending you're doing is not good enough? And that's the question we need to ask. That SME2 bump up, I think there's a very creditable reduction in the stressed exposures from 1.8 to 1.1% or something. I don't know which of these stressed parties has actually paid them money back and how they managed to get it back, but I think it's very creditable.
Okay. By the way, Deepin, just hold on to that, because the market is selling off into the early morning rally. The Sensex, in fact, has gone into the red right now. The pressure, of course, was coming from Infosys, but now on TCS as well. And a lot of the banks have started to showcase
banks
pressure.
Banks have sold suddenly.
Kotak, HDFC, all of them down about half odd percent. So as you were saying, you know, this rally is not sustainable.
Can't extrapolate this market. You know, that's the problem. You know, this is a range market, and you know, it's working like a program. 11,350 you're selling, 11,250 you're buying. It's working, and you know, if something is working in the market, people will do
latch
that.
Latch on to that.
Will latch on to that. At some point, this trade will give way, but right now it's working. So I think at lower level again they would be buying. At higher level selling, we have to just get used to
that. We have to deal with the volatility.
Yes, yes.
All right, Deepin, you know, in your note, you do say that you're hearing good things on auto retail numbers. We're also hearing that the sentiment may have picked up, but it's not translated into numbers just yet. Would this be a good time to buy names like Maruti, M&M, etc., or would you still stay away?
Yeah, that's a dicey one, Sonia. So, we are told, and there is no data to corroborate this, that retail sales have been very good in the days leading up to Diwali, Dashera, etc., and especially on Maruti. I suspect some of that is a dead cat bounce. We couldn't get worse, and so on. I think the big question which is being asked is not whether, you know, financing is going to be available or whether consumer sentiment. I think the question which is being asked for many of these auto companies is, are they aligned with the new realities of the auto market? So I can say all the good things that I want to about Hero Moto, but do they have a great 10-year view of their business where they are aligned with the electric bike market? Maruti, are they aligned with the electric vehicles or electric cars market? And can they ride their current dealer network to take advantage of that market? Mm-hmm. Will the rideshare blokes eat into incremental revenues as we see the millennial generation say, we don't want to buy cars, how are you going to overcome that hurdle? Will the rural interiors continue to deliver incremental growth for Maruti the way they have done so far? I think many of those answers are to be found in the strategic decisions and capital allocations that these managements make, as also the macro eco path that India adopts over the next 5 years. And I suspect that is also a very, very gray area. We've seen growth coming off to 5% in the latest numbers. We've seen the last IIP print also getting into negative. And I think this entire, you know, this global slowdown, the 3.5-4% going to 2%, Brexit, trade wars, India slowing down, it doesn't bode well for these cyclical sectors.